Hi everybody, this is Dr. A, and I'm bringing you your next video in the series on quality, and we're going to look at reference interval studies and how reference intervals are established. Okay, so lab data is used to make clinical decisions, and reference intervals help clinicians make those decisions. So a reference interval is a pair of medical decision points that span the limits of the results that are expected for a given condition or expected maybe in a normal population. So it usually has a lower end and a higher end, and most people would fall somewhere in between those two points. It includes all data points that will define the range of observations with that condition. And it is established by the scientific community or by the manufacturers of the reagents for the test. The reference values will vary with innumerable factors, but especially between laboratories and between geographical locations. So this is something to consider if somebody is traveling or has lived in different areas of the world, and the medical charts, if they travel, whatever. It's practiced to just use the established reference intervals for that location that are attached to that report. And so sometimes things aren't comparable between different geographical locations. So each lab must provide a physician with the information on the range of reference values for that particular lab, for that particular test. This is especially true for tests that are done by immunoassays. They are not interchangeable between laboratories and between different methodologies. So always refer to the ranges that are attached to the specific report given for that specific test. So in developing reference values, they were previously referred to as normal values. The proper statistical tools of sampling, selection of the comparison group, and analysis of data must be used. The normal range or reference range is a range in which 95% of the healthy population will fall within that range for that analyte. That means, though, that there are 5% of the healthy population that might fall outside of that reference range. And so, you know, sometimes a patient could be outside of the reference range, maybe not by much, and still be healthy. There's still nothing wrong with that. So, it's good to take that into consideration. Now, therapeutic ranges are the reference interval for a therapeutic drug. Now, if you think about that, most healthy people would not be on the therapeutic drug. So that's why it has a different name. And that range is established based on the toxicity levels that have been established for that specific drug and the minimum effective dose level. And so the lower end of the range would be the minimum effective dose level, and the higher end of the range will be the toxicity level. So if you're above the high end, you could be toxic. If you're below the low end, then the drug is potentially not having its therapeutic effects. And those are only for drugs that we need to monitor because their toxicity level is close to their therapeutic level. Reference ranges are used for three purposes. They're used to diagnose a disease, monitoring a condition, and monitoring a therapeutic drug. And reference ranges can vary across the lifespan. So there are some ranges that could be different for a newborn versus a one-year-old versus a child versus an adolescent, maybe even versus an adult. A lot of time ranges for adolescent and adults are pretty much the same, but there are certain analytes that do change as the lifespan changes. And there's also been talk about doing ranges and changing ranges or establishing ranges for the geriatric population on certain analytes. Okay, so good lab practice requires establishing or verifying the reference ranges for any new test or whenever there's any significant changes in the methodology of the test. So what's the difference between establishing and verifying a reference interval? So establishing a reference interval is done when there's no existing reference method or test to compare it to. It's brand new. A current situation would have been the advent of the COVID testing. So when that came on the market, there was nothing to compare it to because we haven't had to do this before. And so the manufacturers of these tests had to do some studies to determine, you know, how the cutoffs are. Is the test acting right? What's negative? What's positive? What's healthy? You have the disease. And when you establish a reference interval, it is often costly and labor intensive. It can require as many as 120 individuals, but that's the minimum. It can go as much as 700 or more study subjects. And when you establish a reference interval, then when you have your full population of, it's not really population, your full sample size, so whether it's 120, 500, 700 subjects, you have all that data, then you can use descriptive statistics, you can establish the mean and the 95% confidence interval for that, if you need a range, if you need two decision points, or if it's something that's where it's a positive or negative, there's a different way to do that. Verifying a reference interval, though, is done when there's already an interval that's been established for a similar method or on a similar instrument. And the reference interval can be validated using a comparison method study or by doing smaller reference interval study. You need as few as 40 study subjects. If you don't remember the comparison method study, go back to the basic statistics video in the beginning of the quality series. Established ranges may need to be verified occasionally as the population changes or as the reagent manufacturing changes. So it's good to keep an eye on the ranges to see if there might be some potential problems developing. And there's always the issue of sample selection bias. And we're going to talk about that when we talk about a little bit when we talk about selecting subjects. But if you think basically the people that you can recruit to volunteer to donate samples that are, you know, meet the criteria to be healthy may or may not represent the actual general healthy population. So there's that too. So finding the right people to establish the reference interval. So it is a process. You can't just grab anybody off the street. So you need to determine what your inclusion and exclusion criteria are going to be for your study subjects. So is it okay for you to do studies on males and females, or do you need only males or only females? For example, if you are studying the pregnancy hormones, you probably only take females. And if you were studying the prostate-specific antigen, you would only do males, right? What are things that would cause a person to be excluded? It could be things like certain prescription medications or other factors like maybe being overweight or something like that. But you have to define what might interfere with the test. So you have to search the literature and all that and then decide what the criteria are. So that would require extensive literature searches and review from the lab directors to determine who do we include, who do we exclude to get the correct group of study individuals to establish this reference interval. And this then requires a well-written confidential questionnaire and consent form to screen individuals so that you can come up with your proper sample. The subjects cannot be inpatients in the hospital, which is, sad in a way because we have a lot of inpatients in the hospital. They're right there. We're drawing blood on them all the time. But because they're hospitalized, they're rarely healthy, you know, at that time at least. We can often recruit from volunteers in medical programs. So medical students, nursing students, can often be recruited, public health workers. And these study individuals might require partitioning into subgroups if that is appropriate for, you know, the condition or the test that is being studied. Then there are some pre-analytic and analytic considerations to look over. So those variables must be controlled and standardized to get a good valid reference interval. So you have to have knowledge of the analyte that you're studying, the analytic parameters, you know, what your analyzer can measure for that analyte, the methodology that is used to detect the analyte, and the instrumentation that is needed. So you have to have thorough knowledge of all of that so you can control for as many of the variables as possible. The pre-analytic variables to control for are going to be subject preparation for testing, whether or not they're on prescription medications and which ones they might be on, food, beverage, ingestion, do we need to do this fasting, does it matter if they've eaten, is distress affected, does the collection time affect it, how are the samples stored, and does that affect the testing? And then the analytical considerations are going to be the precision, accuracy, and linearity of the test, and any interference from hemolysis, leukemia, or other things. Doing recovery studies also is a possibility to wade through some of those. So do we spike the samples with a certain concentration of analyte to see how they respond? Is there any lot variations for the reagents? So this can be especially true if you're studying 700 individuals. You know, you buy a lot of reagents. Do you buy enough to do all 700 or 1,000, and can you get enough in, within one lot to do that? Or do you end up with like four or five different lots? And is there any variation between the lots when you do the testing? So those are all things to consider. So it's actually quite a complex thing that we really take for granted because those reference ranges are right there on the lab report. So whenever you look at over in your comparing results to reference ranges, always take into consideration everything that comes into establishing a reference range. Okay, so that wraps it up for this one, and I will see you in the next video.